It's because like, there's another film as well that IFC films have, but they've got Che or whatever.
Oh, they bought it?
Yeah, they've bought that, but they also have a film called Hunger, which is an Irish film.
Oh, I've heard that.
Which
that's
won the
terrific.
Camera d'Or for Best First Film at Cannes this year. It's directed by Steve McQueen.
Not the late Steve McQueen.
No, not Steve McQueen rising from the grave with a Loudhailer. No, this is a performance artist from London.
Oh, did he just pick the name out of a hat or
no,
something?
No, that's where his boy is. It's his name, yeah. And he's won the Turner Prize, which is one of the most important and prestigious art world prizes in London. But it's a film, a true story about an IRA hunger striker in prison.
I heard it's just wonderful.
And there's a young Irish actor who is superb, Michael Fassbender. He's really going to go places. He's got a lot of movies coming up. He's just joined the cast of Tarantino's Inglourious Basterds. He's going to be playing Heathcliff in a new version of Wuthering Heights for John Maybury. And
an old friend, yes.
Oh, good.
Yes.
And if they get a campaign behind that, because he does the whole thing, playing a hunger striker, he loses all the weight and becomes skeletal.
He'll be nominated. It's done.
Watch out for him, Michael Fassbender. He was actually born in Germany and lived there in Heidelberg for 2 years. And then his dad, who's German, his mother, who's Irish, they moved to Ireland and opened a restaurant. And Michael Fassbender and I went to the same school, albeit some years apart, because he's a little bit younger than me.
As is Philip Seymour Hoffman, but after Synecdoche, he started to look like I do now.
I think I aged when I was watching that movie.
Yes, it seemed like it took forever.
It really did crawl along.
Charlie Kaufman's. Wrote and directed. This will be the only film he'll ever be allowed to direct because it will never get distributed.
He might get his fictitious brother. You remember he wrote was an adaptation with his fictitious brother.
That's right. I forgot about that. Yes, but this he directed himself, and it's not directed
really.
Well, yes, it's an incomprehensible film with brilliant performances by the greatest bunch of actors around
today. Oh, yeah, great cast, but the material is so thin. And the most familiar sound at the screening in Cannes, where it was the world premiere, was seats popping up as people left early.
The slam of seats going up in Cannes.
It was the same here for the Spike Lee movie this week. I don't know how many people left during the press screening.
Which is called?
Miracle at St. Anna. Spike goes to war in Tuscany.
It was long.
It's long. It's almost 3 hours. I looked at my watch. Spike. I don't know how many times. it was just.
And you were still there.
I stayed there to the bitter end, but bored.
Yeah, me too. Well, yeah.
Boring. Because then a few days beforehand, there was this Canadian film that opened the festival, and there was another war movie.
Passchendaele.
Yeah, and that was not only boring, but very stiff as well, I thought, and very, very poorly scripted. And then. And 2 days later, I saw a great war movie.
Which was
the
what?
Best Iraq war movie I've seen, The Hurt Locker.
Oh,
directed
yes.
by Catherine Bigelow, who knows how to direct action better than most men, possibly all
and
men.
And we know Catherine Bigelow because she's directed...
Point Break and Near Dark and Strange Days and The Widowmaker, that submarine film with Liam Neeson. And she's been married to James Cameron. I met them on their honeymoon, actually, in San Sebastian Film Festival. Many years ago when he was there with The Abyss and they were on their honeymoon and we had lunch.
Oh, that Catherine Bigelow. That's where I know her. Yeah. She's James Cameron's first ex-wife.
Yeah, that's right, because I don't think the marriage lasted much longer than the lunch we had, actually.
Yeah, probably. It was a long lunch.
But anyway, she's done this movie. It was a very long lunch. It's very leisurely in Spain, you know. Yeah. We were in the hotel. Christina, which is the poshest hotel.
You know what I've seen that I think you might like? It's a film about, it's called Public Enemy Number One.
Oh, I loved it, yeah.
Oh, you saw it?
Yeah, it's a shame it's only part one, though.
We saw part two last night.
How did you see that? I pirated a copy?
No, they just grabbed us. We were walking along, and they grabbed us, Andrew, and my camera. Shout out to Andrew Lyman-Clarke, our cameraman. We got pulled into it. It's not for review, so I can't say anything about it.
Okay, but they'll be just showing it secretly.
Yes. It was a secret, so I can't say anything about it, except that it exists.
Because I've seen a bit of it. I've seen the beginning of it, because they
the
showed
beginning,
the beginning.
The first part is fabulous.
But they showed the beginning of part two at the beginning of part one as well.
It's a tiny little fraction of it, just a tease.
But it's a cracking film. It really moves along.
What's the correct name of it?
It's got several titles.
Yes, they keep doing that. The French, they keep changing the title. They don't care.
I don't know what it's called today. You know, they probably changed it again after having that screening last night. Probably did a survey.
It's now called the Stephen Holt Show.
Why not? No.
Because I liked it so much.
Le Show de Stephen Holt.
Right. Well, I helped Marion Cotillard, which we talked about last year, get her. I took the Oscar and put it in her hand. I had the only American interview with her.
Really?
And it went on Oscar Watch, which turned into Awards Daily because the Academy sued poor Sasha. And then it went on to my site on YouTube. And then there was a writer's strike. So the only place people could see how beautiful and young and smart and funny Marion Cotillard really is was on my site because there was no TV shows to put her on. You didn't know about this. There's a writer's strike. So...
Oh, yeah, but did.
So the Parisian film crew filmed me talking to Marion and put me on the special features in France. So now I'm a French national hero. Vive la France. So maybe the next
time... But, I'm a Chevalier des Arts de Lettres. I have a cultural knighthood from the French government.
Oh, mon Dieu. Well, I've got to get one there. I got to get... Well, maybe we'll
see. Very few people in Ireland have them, actually. It's only about four.
Say that again.
Very few Irish people...
Pronounce it again.
Chevalier des Arts et des Lettres. A commander of arts and letters.
Oh, congratulations.
Yeah, I was inaugurated.
Félicitations.
Yes, merci, monsieur. I wasn't inaugurated. I was kind of... This ceremony was performed 2 years ago, yeah.
Michael, that's wonderful.
Yeah, I was thrilled. I just got this
letter. They'll always have to let you into Cannes.
Oh, yeah, it's great.
So maybe I'll see you there.
I've just done my 27th Cannes this year. 27 years in a row.
What color pass do you have?
I have a very good one. If you get a blue pass, don't even go, because you see the people with the blue passes, they're standing by the side of the steps until the last minute, and then if there's a few seats inside, they go, you, and they let in a few of them,
And it's broiling hot sun, and absolutely. A heart attack standing there, yeah.
And the screening started at 8:30 every morning, every morning, including Sundays.
It sounds heinous.
And, then you say there's 9 different levels of press accreditation, and then you can hardly walk the street at night because all the local people are out to watch the red carpet, which is a huge affair. With they have a gendarme standing on the left and right of every one of the steps going up to the top.
I'm standing with my mouth open, going like up an to idiot, the palace. Like I'm surprised.
On either side, you've got maybe 40 or 50 photographers on either side, all in black tie. They're not allowed into the pen. Unless they're completely black tie. And it's just a big ceremony with music pounding out and everyone putting up in their beautiful cars and beautiful gowns and making their way up the red carpet and preening and posing.
Where would that leave me? I don't know, it sounds heinous. But maybe I won't go. Anyway.
It's something you have to do once. But walking up the red carpet in Cannes. It's one of those things you have to do once in your life is walk up the red carpet in Cannes. It is such a buzz. And, most of the people there don't know more than a few people in the film, but you're only the big star, so you can start waving to them. They think you're a superstar. And
right. Once again, you're the only person on my show with a priority pass here. Yes, I where's mine? I've got an I, which I don't mean, does that mean I'm just an industry? I don't know.
Who knows? I mean, all these great mysteries of life.
Yes. Well, I like you're walking into the shot today on the Stephen Holt Show, and I'm running into you. Michael, I think we just did a whole 26-minute program.
Very good.
Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
My favorite guest and your favorite guest, Michael Dwyer, now coming to you from YouTube in parts 1, 2, and 3. Anyway, thank you so much.
And 24.
Thank you so much.
My pleasure,
I guess I'll
Stephen.
See you in the same place next year.
I'll give you a call in New York next time.
Okay, sure. Yeah. Absolument, monsieur.
And we can go up and do something on the top of the Empire State, maybe, or somewhere with a more interesting visual backdrop than this hotel.
And now thank you, Michael Dwyer, for catching us all up here at the Stephen Holt Show at the Toronto International Film Festival 2008. How did it get to be so late already? But we're still having fun, right? The thing is to keep having fun and to keep going and to keep watching the Stephen Holt Show and to keep coming to the Toronto International Film Festival. And it's all about the CN Tower. I don't know, why can't I stop looking at that great big thing? Have a fabulous CN Tower.